business as usual. This is nothing fancy. This is what we know. This is the way. This is what we're doing now. This is not all the. This is not the gains that we're expected to get and all the other things when we get all the architects on board and everything else. This is where we are now. We're actually added 30 billion square feet to our building stock, and our energy consumption in the U.S. is less.
The Green Ribbon Commission, if you don't know, was created by the late great Mayor Menino and Amos Hostetter a few years ago, and it's an advisory group of 34 leaders from business and industry that share strategies to help the city fight climate change and to support the climate action plan. So this is an advisory group. It's a very influential group, and Ed was in town today to address the Green Ribbon Commission. So thanks, Barr Foundation, and thanks, Green Ribbon Commission. John, seminal research into the sustainability, resilience, energy consumption, and greenhouse gas emissions of the built environment has redefined the role of architects, planning, design, and building in reshaping our world. He's the founder of Architecture 2030, a think tank developing real-world solutions for 21st century problems. Ed, you ready? Let's go.
Well, thank you very much, and thanks for inviting me. The Green Ribbon Commission, that was actually an excellent meeting, I think. And I'm going to actually show you what I showed them, so kind of toward the middle. It was a very short presentation. They gave me 15 minutes. John gave me 15 minutes. But it's in this presentation, so you'll kind of toward the end. So let's just get started. Let's talk about the road to zero. I really want to talk about the architecture community. Hopefully what I'll illustrate is the power that we have to change the world. That no matter what transpires in Paris at the UNFCCC negotiations, no matter what commitments are made by governments, if we don't take the reins and make the changes, everything fails. We don't get there. So it essentially puts us in the role of solving the greatest issue of modern times. And I think you'll see that when I'm done with this presentation, hopefully. Okay, so this is Marrakesh, very hot, dry climate, 31 degrees north latitude, down by Florida, south of Florida. You can see, you can't even see the streets. They're so narrow. There are lots of streets in there. And you see that all the buildings are donuts. Why are they donuts? Well, this is the pre-industrial part of the city. And essentially, you had a daylight every space. There was no electricity at that time. And so buildings were donuts. Streets were very, very narrow. You got daylight in from both sides. They were courtyards, very hot climate, so they planted the courtyards, and people lived in the courtyards, the actual living space. And this is what it looked like. This is what it looks like today, but this is what it looked like in pre-industrial times also. The courtyards were all shaded, had water elements. The streets were very, very narrow. Everything was masonry. So at night, you have a big diurnal swing, so at night, temperatures are much, much cooler, like there's 30-degree difference, 30, 40-degree difference between daytime and nighttime temperatures in dry climates. The cold air settles, cools off all that masonry. You shade all, because the buildings are so tight, you only get maybe half hour of sun into that space as the sun goes over. So you basically have cool surfaces all day, so you can actually walk outdoors in places like that. Now we go all the way up to Vienna, Austria, 48 degrees north latitude. That's way north, like in southern Canada. And you see donuts again in the pre-industrial part of the town. Again, donuts. All buildings are kind of donut shaped. But now the streets are much, much wider. Obviously, there's snow. You want to melt the snow. You want to get sun when you're walking around. Very, very climate adaptive. But in all cases, buildings were masonry wall buildings, spans were short, you had to bring the loads down, floor to floor heights were high, windows were vertical and high, so you can get enough daylight throw in to maximize your daylight and get enough width in the buildings, and that was pre-industrial. And here's a courtyard of one of the buildings in the northern part of the world. So this is Toronto, 1891, and you can see again masonry buildings, high floor to floor heights, vertical windows. Keep your eye on the Flatiron building, which is the one right above 1891. And let's fast forward that from 1891 to today. And you could see the Flatiron building is a four-story, four-and-a-half-story, half basement with an attic. And the building right to the right of that brick building, is a nine-story building, same height. Floor to floors come down. You can condition space. You can see the huge blank wall. So we can condition space, and everything became horizontal. Everything came down. This is Boston, 1888, and that's what it looks like today. Again, the Iron Pei skyscraper. This is Shanghai around 1990. This is looking over. Yeah, now keep your eye on the building with the tower, clock tower there, okay? I'm going to fast forward 25 years. That's Shanghai today in 25 years. But again, you know, same. If you look at the skyscrapers, same skyscrapers, same building types. So how did we get from that to this? And if you try to walk around in the Pudong area, which was that area I just showed you, there's a separation of car and pedestrians. Pedestrians are on the upper level, cars are running around on the bottom level. And the pedestrians actually move from building to building on these walkways that are high up. How did all that happen? Well, in the turn of the century, coal was the dominant player. It was the dominant energy source. The Industrial Revolution was in full swing. You had factories and plants and everything and housing all mixed together. The lifespan in England at that time was like 35 years old. People died of emphysema and all sorts of things. So it's pretty bad. You didn't have, you know, you couldn't get light into buildings. Everything was kind of packed in. The architects and planners of the time got together, and they held their first Congress in 1928 called the International Congress of Modern Architecture. And it's Le Corbusier, Gropius, Aalto, and they laid out a set of guiding principles. And these were based on reform and social justice. It was a utopian movement, and it was really heroic. And they set out to change the world. And so they set out a bunch of planning principles, function-based zones. Get the housing, separate the housing and the industry, get the industry out of the housing so that people could actually breathe and live. They call for high-rise housing blocks in the best land, not the worst land, which was what was happening at the time. They call for abundant parks, the housing blocks and parks. They call for sunlight into all spaces. And they call for free and efficient circulation. The automobile was in, and we were now transporting goods and services by automobile and truck. Le Corbusier developed a design for the Radiant City where he separated the automobiles and movement of goods and services on the main level and had the walkways on the level above for pedestrians. He also set out a set of guiding principles for architecture. He called for column wall separation, so no more bearing walls. Use columns, beams, and then hang the walls off of the structure. That would open up the plan, so we wouldn't have masonry walls in very, very short spans. We would then be able to free the design of the facades and actually do curtain walls, all glass facades, to get light and air into the spaces. And he called for horizontal bands of windows now that we didn't have to bring the structure down. The first modern building attributed to the Bauhaus was in the 1920s, 1925, and you can see the structures inside, no bearing walls, and the exterior wall is all glass hung from the structure. From that point, Philip Johnson and Henry Russell Hitchcock brought the modern movement over from Europe to the U.S. in a major exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art in 1932, and they called it the international style. The reason is that we could take those guidelines and apply them anywhere in the world. Didn't matter at this point. So it was now a style. And from that, you have the beautiful Lever House and the first full city plan based on the principles of the modern movement. And modernism was based, obviously, on fossil fuels because it could be an international style. We could take the same building type that you saw in Pudong and anywhere else in the world and just overcome the exterior environment by using fossil fuels. It's now 2015, and we have a new problem. And we are the only ones that can solve this problem, similar to the way it happened back at the turn of the century. And I'll show you why. Today, world population is about 7.2 billion people. By 2030, world population is expected to increase another 1.1 billion people. By 2030, world urban population is expected to increase by 1.1 billion people, absorbing the entire population growth globally, meaning that all the construction is going to happen in urban areas and cities. And that's what we're finding today. So over the next two decades, there'll be about 900 billion square feet of building built, and this will be new buildings and tear down and rebuild new buildings in urban areas. This is just in urban areas worldwide. That's an area equal to 60% of the entire building stock of the world. This is what I showed today. It's like building a New York City or rebuilding a New York City every 35 days globally. That's how much construction we're doing. If we get it right, we solve the climate problem. If we don't get it right, we lock in emissions and energy consumption for 80 to 100 years. 80 years is the average lifespan of a building globally, and 120 years is the infrastructure that goes along with that building. So where's most of this construction going to take place? Well, 53% of all this construction over the next two decades is going to take place in China. We know that, 38%. But second is North America. The U.S. and Canada, another 15% takes place. So between the U.S. and China, 53% of all construction is going to take place over the next two decades. Then after that cycle is over, then you have India coming in and Africa and stuff like that. So if we get that right, we have a huge opportunity to set the tone globally. We also know where all the emissions are coming from. 75% comes from urban environments, from cities. And we know that in order to stay under 2 degrees centigrade, we need to phase out CO2 emissions in urban environments by about 2050. Now, why do we say 2050? And this afternoon, John Holdren, who addressed the commission, said we need to get on track to have a 50% chance of staying under 2 degrees C. Well, let me talk about that for a minute. These are the four scenarios that was run, and Holdren was talking about one of these, which was the 2.6 scenario. These are the four scenarios that the IPCC ran. And they have different phase-out times. Oh, good. Thank you. They have different phase-out times. different peaks and different phase out times. And you can see the 2.6 peaks around 2020 and then phases out by about 2080. So you eliminate CO2 emissions by about that time. And each one of those scenarios burns all different amounts of carbon. The only scenario that gives us a chance of staying under 2 degrees C is the 2.6 scenario, phasing out by 2070. But that's a 66% chance. That was the one, that was what Holden was talking about today. But that gives us a 33% chance of blowing, of going over 2 degrees C, and I'll tell you why this is not good. You should have seen his talk today. It was the, you know, what's going to fall on us is a nightmare. But so the scientific community ran a fourth scenario, another RCP 2.6. And they said, let's peak a little sooner between 2016 and 2020 and phase out CO2 emissions by 2050, hence the roadmap to 2050. That gives us a high probability, an 85% or better chance of staying under 2 degrees C. Now, why is that 2.6 really important? And why is it important to actually have a high probability? The other three scenarios, if you pass 2 degrees C, the planet keeps on warming. You cannot bring it back. It's game over. So a 50% chance, 66% chance, whatever you want to call it, is terrible odds playing with this kind of problem. Once you pass 2 degrees, there's so much inertia and so much CO2 that you put in the atmosphere, it stays up there for hundreds of years, and it just doesn't come down, and the planet just keeps on warming. There's a big lag time. So if we don't make it, we're in really big trouble. If we meet the 2.6 scenario, and we have a good chance of doing that, then the planet doesn't reach 2 degrees C. It gets to about 1.5, 1.6, 1.7, and then starts coming back because we phased out emissions, and now the ocean uptake and the land uptake and the plant uptake begins to take the carbon out at a slow rate, but we still begin to come back. So it is the only plausible option that we have. And the only group that can get us to that is you. In 2003, we discovered the building sector, and there was the Architects Pollute issue, which now is kind of iconic. It was a great cover. But it was the first time we realized that we were not only the problem, but we were the solution. And in 2006, we formed Architecture 2030. I left architecture practice, and we've been working on solutions within our sector. And we issued back then the 2030 challenge. We called, in 2015, we called for a 70% fossil fuel reduction in operating buildings, the more renewables you use, you just offset that energy. So we know that buildings need energy. So we're at a 70% reduction today. In 2020, we call for an 80% fossil fuel reduction. In 2025, 90%. And in 2030, we're calling for all buildings to be carbon neutral. That doesn't mean they don't use energy. They use energy, but not fossil fuel, carbon-emitting, CO2-emitting energy. We discovered that, I'll show you that in a minute. We discovered what was happening in the U.S. to the building sector, and we built a program around what the architecture community and planning community was accomplishing in the U.S. and took that to Europe. Before we took that to Europe, the ambitions were very low. When we showed what was going on in the U.S., which I'll show you in a minute, all of a sudden, ambitions were raised. It was amazing to see, because they thought the U.S. was really holding everything back and realized that we were moving ahead, actually very quickly, quicker than anybody else. We put all that in a roadmap to zero emissions, went to the next meeting, UNFCCC meeting in Bonn, and presented the whole roadmap. We also called for not only meeting the 2030 targets for new buildings and major renovations, but also for the developed countries to reduce by 50% on a 2 to 3% square footage a year of total building stock, reduce by 50% their energy consumption of their building stock. 2 to 3% of their building stock a year, reduce it by 50% out over time, and then developing countries, the same reduction, but only 1.5 to 2% of their building stock. So that was all in the roadmap. And if you meet that roadmap, this is what we presented at the OECD in Paris and in Bonn. This is CO2 emitting energy that we use globally and non-CO2 emitting. So renewables, hydro, nuclear is up there. So about three quarters, a little more than three quarters of all energy consumption in the world is CO2 emitting fossil fuels. And this is just the building sector, global building sector. If we implement that strategy, the 2030 targets for new buildings and 50% for a portion of the building stock every year, then we begin to reduce the energy consumption of buildings by 1.25% annually. And you can see that by 2050, by phasing in, by doubling the amount of renewables that we have globally now, we're able to actually phase out CO2 emissions in the world. This was really heartening to the parties. So, what did I show them in Paris? I showed them that we issued the 2030 challenge targets, that 70% of the top 20 AE firms have adopted the targets and are working to meet the targets. That doesn't mean they're all meeting them on all the buildings, we know that, but they're working toward it and they're starting to make good progress. The latest DI survey shows that 54% of US firms have adopted the targets and that 63%, this was a heartening number, of AE firms feel they could meet the carbon neutral target by 2030. That was in the 30s and 40s years back. It's now up to 63%. The federal government has adopted the targets in Section 433 of the Energy Independence and Security Act. Phase out all CO2, all fossil fuels for building operations and new buildings and major renovations in all federal facilities by 2030. That's the law. Today, it's 65% reduction, and the DOE finally issued the rules on how to do that. So the rules have been issued. The fossil fuel companies and their constituents in Congress are trying to get this repealed. And so the AIA has been fighting. The AIA has been doing an incredible job keeping 433 in law. California, we work with them. They've adopted the 2030 targets for commercial buildings and did one better, 10 years better on new residential buildings, zero net energy by 2020 by code, and they've now set out their code processes to get to those targets. And many states and cities and counties have adopted in various forms or another the 2030 targets. The IA has the 2030 commitment that you're all familiar with. There are now 325 firms benchmarking and more important reporting, and the reporting has gone up this year dramatically, which is really great. Not everybody's meeting the 70%, but there are some interesting findings in that. When people actually run simulation programs and begin the process very early on in the design, they have a much, much greater chance of meeting the targets. We have 2030 districts that go to a 50% reduction in the whole district by 2030 energy consumption and emissions, and those districts are spreading like mushrooms all around the country They're private sector-led, and there's a bunch more forming now in other cities. They're building owner, private sector-led, and then they bring the public sector in afterwards. So they're private-public partnerships. And then, you know, the AI Plus 2030 series, it ran in 27 markets in the U.S. and Canada, and the AI is now doing an online series. So how do we get to zero or carbon neutral? Well, what we say at Architecture 2030 is, and as designers, is that it's a two-step process. The first step, the biggest reduction, comes in design. It's how we design our buildings. It's really design and planning, everything from how we locate our buildings, transportation systems, density, walkable communities, all the way down to building design, building form, daylighting, different kinds of passive strategies, what color the building's made out of, what kind of elements, shading elements, all these things enter into design, and we know from the 70s and 80s, you can squeeze anywhere from 50 to 80% of the energy consumption out of a building, from a typical building. And our codes are now at 50%. So we know you can squeeze another 20, 30% out from a typical building. But all buildings need energy, and so we say make up the rest with not fossil fuel energy, but renewable energy. Everything from site renewables, site-scale renewables, whatever you can get on site, to utility-scale, to microgrids, neighborhood-scale, all the way to utility-scale renewables. We also know that there's an information gap. We need the information in order to be able to design down to get to that 50, 60, 70, 80% reduction. The information that's out there is highly technical, in many cases. It's compartmentalized, we're finding that there's a limited audience for this within the architecture and planning community, although that's changing. In order to solve part of the information gap, we took a stab at it, and we developed the 2030 palette, which is online now at www.2030palette.org, and it lays out all the principles, the guiding principles for planning and design, all the way down to building elements, and we're continually building that out. It's an ongoing process, really a love of architecture. So where are we today, and what did we show in Paris and in Bonn that really began to move the needle? We showed the U.S. building sector. This was the projection in 2005. The building sector was using about 40 quads of energy. That's a unit of energy. The whole U.S. uses about 90-something quads. So the building sector is like 40-something percent. So in 2005, the building sector was consuming 40 quads of energy, and the Energy Information Administration, the part of the DOE, projected that by 2030, the building sector, because of all the buildings we've been adding, we were adding about 5 billion square feet a year of new building back then. We would need 43% more energy to operate the building sector. Remember, the recession hits in about 2007, middle of 2007. 2007, before the recession, the projections came down. The targets were issued, and we discovered the building sector in 2002 to 2003 when the Metropolis came out. People started to get on board. You had the GBC, you had LEED, information was getting out there. So the energy consumption leveled out a bit for a year or two, but the projections were still up. 2009, you had the recession. Half of that big jump down was we weren't building that many more buildings, because we went down from 5 billion square feet to about 1.75 billion square feet. And so we had a big reduction. But about half of that was also efficiency gains in design, construction, engineering, products. Now, from 2009, built into the DOE models is the recession. So 2011, there's a drop again. 2013, we actually reduced emissions in the building sector from 2005 all the way out to 2013, and the projections were almost flat. Now 2015, we're down again. We're actually flat, business as usual. This is nothing fancy. This is what we know. This is the way, this is what we're doing now. This is not all the, this is not the gains that we're expected to get and all the other things when we get all the architects on board and everything else. This is where we are now. We're actually added 30 billion square feet to our building stock, and our energy consumption in the U.S. is less. You know why we, Obama's issued the, you know, we're going to phase out coal and all that kind of stuff? Coal is phasing itself out because there's no demand. Actual capacity in the U.S. is down. So all the nuclear plants have been canceled. Coal plants that are coming of age are being phased out, not because there's regulations or anything. It's because there's no demand. Demand is going down, and 75% of all the power that's produced in the United States goes to buildings, building operations. And that's what you've done, and that's what we presented in Europe. Now, that's just business as usual. This is if we just use what we have that's really efficient, high-efficiency boilers, better glazing, better insulation, everything else. If we incorporate that in our building, the IA projects we're down. That doesn't even include design strategies. They have no clue about design. They don't understand what architects do. Very few people do. But when you put in design strategies, we're going down through the floor on this. You remember the AARA and all the money to put money back into the economy? That number, that's $560 billion are what consumers were expected to pay in the U.S. for energy by 2030. $560 billion is what they didn't pay. That's the same as the whole bailout during the recession. That's what Congress approved, I think $580 billion, something like that. Now look at these numbers. So we got a double whammy. This is how much money that consumers are expected to save that they were going to pay by 2030 that they're not going to pay. It's in the trillions of dollars. The numbers are absolutely staggering. So we issued another imperative. We called it the 2050 imperative. The AIA took it to Durban, South Africa, during the International Union of Architects, where all the architecture organizations from all over the world got together. They said it doesn't have a chance of passing. Somehow the guy from Australia, Australia Institute of Architects, got a hold of it and said, we got to pass this, brought it, somehow got it to the floor, and unanimous. So the architecture organizations globally have pledged for their members, 1.3 million architects, that they're going to design to carbon neutral standards. Are they going to do it? Not right away, but once you get this going, then it has a snowball effect. We then heard from the Chinese, well, the U.S. wasn't. It's a long story, but anyway, we went to China over a three-year period. We got all the international firms that have offices in China, like Skidmore and Gensler and everybody else, to sign on to a China court pledging that all their city planning, developments, and buildings, they were designed to carbon neutral standards, or, and we understand that in high density areas it's difficult to do, high performance and with the ability to import renewables to get those projects to carbon neutral. This just got signed 2 weeks ago by, took me 2 years to get the international firms to sign on. Within 4 months, we had the largest local design institutes from every region in China, 28 local design institutes, sign on to the accord. And the CEDAAB, which is the acronym for the organization like the AIA for all the local design institutes, was the one who instigated it, and they signed the accord for all the local design institutes. The local design institutes are government-owned, and they took me aside and assured me that when China decides to do something, we will take only months to do it, not years and years to do it, because it's coming down from the government. So they were great. That was an interesting trip. We also, based on those early presentations in Bonn and in Paris, the UNFCCC declared one full day at the Paris negotiations that are taking place this next month, starting November 30th to December 11th. One full day out of that will be devoted just to buildings, to elevate the issue that buildings are critical in order to get this issue solved. Now, that is huge. To devote, you have no idea how bureaucratic the UNFCCC is. To get a full day devoted to buildings was absolutely huge. And we had a bunch of partners pushing for that, but we got it. We got it through. They realized that if they don't get the building sector under control, it's not going to happen. And they know that a lot of that cannot be done by treaties or anything like that, that it's going to be the building sector itself that creates the guidelines and the framework to make a total paradigm shift to get this done. And that's what we need. There's a Carbon Neutral Cities Alliance, but I want you to notice there is Boston. This is an alliance of 17 cities that have agreed to 80% to zero emissions by the year 2030. And I showed this today. Boston has positioned itself right in the middle of this, put itself on the international stage, right in back of the Pope. And so you better believe everybody's looking at Boston. And if you don't make it, it is a big embarrassment. And you don't want the Pope against you. This is a... So this is what I presented today at the commission. How is Boston going to get an 80% reduction in the whole city by 2050? So here's where you are today. You've actually made some gains. This is emissions in Boston, the city of Boston, back to 2005 on the left, and that's where you are today. That's total greenhouse gas emissions in Boston. And Boston has set out two targets. Now, I didn't stretch the thing all the way out, the graph all the way out, so you see 2020 and 2050 right next to each other. Actually, it would go way out to the other side of the room. But the 2020 target is a 25% reduction below 2005 levels, and the 2050 target is an 80% reduction below 2005 levels. You're at a 17% reduction today, but it's starting to go slightly up, and the projections aren't, might actually go even up. How did you get 17% in such a short period of time? Well, you did... took care of the low-hanging fruit. You switch from coal to gas and oil to gas and natural gas, which is lower emitting fossil fuel. And so you've used up the low-hanging fruit. Now starts the real work. And in politics, politicians usually use up the low-hanging fruit really quickly and then leave it to the next guy. Well, that's done. So now the next guy's on the hook. So how are we going to get from 17 to 25 and then all the way to 80? Well, here's the building sector. Still there. 73% of total emissions is just building operations in Boston. So we put together a plan that we presented today to the Green Ribbon Commission on getting to 80 by 50. How can Boston get to 80 by 50? We actually developed a plan for New York. It's very similar. Urban areas are similar. There are about 724 million square feet of building, and I say about because these are numbers we We've been going back and forth with people here to get us information. We haven't had time to do due diligence, so this is very quick and back of the envelope. So there are about 724 million square feet of building in Boston. Boston is adding about 4.5 to 7 million square feet. We think it's 7, and I showed 7 today, not the 4.5. But 4.5 is when I look at the actual statistics that are on the city website, I'm getting 4.5, but the construction companies are telling me it's more like 7 or actually even greater. So I think it's 7. 73% of the city's emissions come from buildings. 93% of all electricity production goes just to operate buildings and the equipment that's in buildings. So two things we have to deal with. We have to deal with that 724 million square feet and the 7 million square feet of new buildings, plus we need to bring in renewable energy. So how are we going to deal with all those three? Well, there is a formula. You do deep efficiency renovations of the 724 million square feet, and you bring the new buildings in at very, very low energy consumptive levels, high performance, new building design, and major renovations also. And then you use renewables to make up the rest. The same thing we had with the design. So we developed the scale for Boston, 100 being the average building energy consumption. The IECC 2015 and ASHRAE 2013 will be adopted in Boston in 2016. That actually gets us a 50% reduction below the average. So it's a really good, aggressive code. But we need to go past that if we're going to get the 80% reduction. So in 2019, we need a 20% better code. In 2022, that'll give us another 10% below the 50%. 2022, we need a 40% code. That'll get us to a 70% total reduction. And by 2030, Boston's going to need, in order to get that 80 by 50, is going to need a zero net energy code for new buildings. Now, what is zero net energy? Well, you use the 40% code, which is essentially prescriptive requirements. You use prescriptive requirements to get down that low, the 70%, which is what we talked about in design. And then the rest has to be made by on-site renewables. But in dense urban areas, you're not going to have the capability to do all on-site renewables. So we say bring in off-site renewables, not off-site fossil fuel energy. And so how do you do all that? We now have, NBI just did for commercial buildings, a design guide to get to 40% below prescriptive requirements. So we know we can get to those codes. We also say that in 2016, when you adopt the IECC and ASHRAE, the latest code standard, develop a 20% better and a 40% better stretch code. In 2019, the 20% stretch code would then be the code, so then you have a 40% and a zero net energy code, stretch code. And then in 2022, when the 40% code is adopted, then you'd have a zero net energy stretch code. And incentivize the hell out of the stretch code so that anybody building a new building will want to do better than the code. And there are a lot of things you can do. There's fast track permitting, put them to the front of the line. Time is money, especially in the building sector. If they can get to the front of the line, that's worth a lot of money. You can give them a density bonus. That's worth a fortune. You can do tax credits, property tax. I mean, there are deductions, rebates, reduced fees, permitting fees. There's financing options and on-bill repayment, but I'll show you how to even do better than that. So there are lots of ways to incentivize the building sector, and the more advanced builders will then take those options. So what are the intervention points for the codes? We know we have that 724 million square feet. Well, obviously new buildings, the 7 million square feet is an intervention point where the code applies, and that's automatic. Major renovations, we want the code to apply to major renovations, not just the portion of the building. If it's a major renovation, then we want it to apply to the whole building. And then we say building purchases, because major renovations will offset the new buildings coming in, especially if they're efficiency renovations. But how are you going to get it to 724 million square feet? The only number that we know to get to most of that is building purchases. There's about 12 to 14 million square feet that changes hands every year. Why are building purchases, especially it's the buyer that needs to make the reductions? Why is that the best place to do it? Because the people who can buy buildings, who can afford to buy buildings, have a lot of money. A lot of them are doing it for investment. A lot of them are doing it to own buildings. You don't buy a building at $300, $400, $500 a square foot, up to probably $1,000 a square foot, if you don't have money and you don't have good credit. And to borrow the little additional amount to meet code is a drop in the bucket. And in commercial buildings, if you show lower operating costs, the amount of money that you can borrow actually goes up. You can probably offset the whole thing. So it's the perfect opportunity. But there are issues with that. We also told the city and state today that you ought to get your house in order and set a target for all 67 million square feet of your building in Boston to get to carbon neutral by 2030 and set the roadmap and set the example for the private sector. And to talk to the colleges and universities where you have the students and activists, and they're supposed to be leading thinkers, to get them to agree to the same thing, 2030 carbon neutral. So at what point do you meet the intervention codes? Well, code compliance. For new buildings and major renovations, you meet the code. You get the building consumption way down through efficiency, through design, and then you do on-site renewables, and that's how you meet the code. You either use the prescriptive requirements or use the on-site renewables to reduce the amount and do the performance path. For building purchases, you can't force people out of a building to do deep renovations, especially if the building's occupied and if you buy it for investment purposes, for example, or you're just going to move into a small piece of the building and you just want to renovate that. So we give the buyer three options. One is you meet the codes and you do on-site renewables. So you actually do, for somebody's going to do a major renovation, they're going to move in to occupy the building, they bought it to occupy, they're going to renovate, they meet the code. If it's in a dense urban area and they can't get the renewables on to get to the code level, then we say buy the rest, but do the efficiency renovations. If you're buying it for investment purposes or you have tenants and you're not going to move them out, you don't want to disturb them, then we say do non-intrusive efficiency requirements like changing out thermostats, occupancy sensors, LED lights, things that don't require much, that don't disturb anyone, but that you can get 10, 15, 20, up to 30% reductions actually in energy consumption, and then buy the rest, renewables. And it has to be newly generated renewables within the metropolitan region or the state if there's not enough renewables being generated. That creates the market for the renewables. In New York City, it costs a penny a kilowatt hour more. Instead of 19, 20, 21 cents, you're at about 17, 18 cents, something like that, depends on time of day, more to buy renewables. And they have to generate the renewables. So this creates the market for renewables. Now, if I'm buying a building at $1,000 a square foot or $500 a square foot, and I don't want to do anything to pay an extra penny, you think they're going to squawk? No way. So now you have the renewables coming in. Every renovation then has to meet the codes. And you begin to get to the reduction targets that you want. And you incentivize now the renewables. You create a whole new market for renewable energy within the area. And that creates the jobs that go with the renewables, because somebody has to build them, somebody has to install them. So what's the benefit for the city in adopting a plan like this? Well, first of all, there's additional tax revenue from all the construction that's going to go on. There's about $300 million a year worth of additional construction to meet the new codes and do the efficiency and put in the renewables. That money can go, the city can use that for all sorts of things, for public housing, fund training programs to put in the renewables, and incentivize the stretch codes, give it back to the private sector for doing better. That program would meet the 80 by 50 target. If you don't do that, and if the architecture community doesn't get on board and design it, you can't meet the target. Impossible. Because of all the additional construction and the renewables, it creates about 4,000 or 5,000 new jobs. That money goes through the economy a bunch of times, and it reduces energy costs across the board. Now, I'm going to end with two slides, and then we'll enter into a discussion. But why am I bullish that this can all happen? If the design community and the planning community does its part, then what about the renewables for all the energy that we're going to actually need? I'm going to put this in motion. This is the cost of a gigajoule. That's a big unit of energy, of electricity, retail electricity, coal, and natural gas over time from 1980 all the way to today with inflation put in. So the cost of energy that that people were paying in 1980, we're paying just about the same amount today. Because basically the cost of energy has only risen by the amount of inflation that's taken place between then and now. Now in 1970s when the energy crisis hit and we started playing around with solar energy and trying to do solar this and solar that and photovoltaics, this was the cost of a gigajoule in 1980, $1,100 a gigajoule. So our graph only goes up to 250. So it's on the ceiling of the next floor is what the cost of solar was. And we were still using it. We were still trying to use it in buildings and everything else. Now I'm going to put in motion what happened since then. This is the cost of a gigajoule of producing electricity using solar energy. It's now at parity with fossil fuels. That doesn't mean storage. Storage is another issue. But producing it, producing the energy, getting it into the grid, is at the same cost as fossil fuels. And what's happened because of that? This is 2001. This is of new energy production globally. 81% was non-renewables, so coal, gas, nuclear, and oil, and 19% was renewables, solar, wind, biomass, hydro. So of all the new energy produced in the world, back in 2001, 81% was fossil fuels and nuclear. Now I'm going to put it in motion to 2014. The crossover point happened in 2012, 2013. Renewables, there's more renewables being built in the world today, new renewables, than new fossil fuels and nuclear combined. And if you think that's going to change, that's not changing. That red line is coming down, and that green line is going up until we phase out CO2 emissions. And once the red line hits, then we've essentially phased out any new fossil fuels coming in, and then we have to get at the entire existing stock of fossil fuels. Thank you.
Test, test.
Hi. Ed, thank you. That was
I don't know. It's been a long time. I don't know if we were expecting so much good news. That's really good. The coal market is drying up. There's more renewable being built. We're actually making energy efficiency gains. This is good, right? This
When I was in Europe, they fell off their chairs that this was going on in the U.S. They thought the U.S. was the stumbling block to any gains in Paris. This was 2 years ago. Everybody was gloom and doom, and nothing's going to happen, and only we're doing something in Europe. And when they saw that what was happening in the U.S., and our State Department didn't even know about it. I had to give the State Department the same presentation in a private, private room in Bonn. They were like, we're actually doing something.
We're actually doing something good. It's good.
Yes.
Yeah. Architects are so naturally optimistic. We need to hear this once in a while. We're actually doing something good. Yeah. Before we do any questions, I want to be just gratuitous here for a second. You know that to a lot of us, we have a lot of architects in the room, a lot of people who've been working in energy efficiency and advocacy. I know a lot of people have put. I'm seeing the wrinkles on the faces of the people who've been working on this for a long time in this community. You are a hero to us, Ed. I just want to say you're a hero to us. So. I've been at this for a while. And one of the guys in my office came up to me today with a book that you wrote in 1979 about solar energy. Really? Is that you've been at it this long?
What got you
started in this anyway?
It was by accident actually. Back then I was teaching. This was in the middle 70s. I was teaching at the University. I left the East Coast. All my friends were going west to make their fortune, so I figured I'd go west. I ended up at the University of New Mexico. It was the 70s. You know, we had long hair, we had jeans, we were a little crazy. Did some things that it was a little conservative in certain parts of New Mexico at that time. They didn't like what I was doing. Anyway. Kind of got kicked out of the university. It's not for public consumption here, but I wanted to go to Berkeley. I desperately wanted to teach at Berkeley. That's where everything was happening back in the 70s. So I applied to Berkeley. I was actually a finalist. They did a national search for one position, and I was one of the three finalists. They flew me out, went through the interviews. I didn't get the job. I was depressed for about a minute because I walked out of the room. And the guy named Bill Dillon, who was the dean at Oregon, was waiting for the two people who didn't get the job. And immediately offered us jobs at Oregon. Because Berkeley did the national search. And Oregon, if you remember the Oregon experiment, and Christopher Alexander was from Berkeley to Oregon, they were like symbiotic schools back then. A lot of cross-fertilization. So anyway, Bill was there and offered us both jobs. And I said, all right, I said, this is interesting. I needed a job. I was out of a job. So I'll teach studio. What else would I, structures, He says, solar energy. I said, Oregon? There's no sun in Oregon. Why do you want solar energy? He said, our students are going crazy for solar energy. They're building testings on the roof. We need an instructor to teach it. You're from the Southwest. You got to know more than we know up in Oregon. That was his rationale, that I was from the Southwest. I said, I don't know anything about solar energy. So to make a long story short, I said, I'll come the next semester. There's no way I can come and teach solar energy. Give me 6 months. I got together with some engineers. By then, if you saw the textbooks on solar energy back in the early 70s, they were this thick and they were all formulas and integers and stuff. You couldn't even read the book if you were an architect. I got an engineer from Sandia National Lab. I said, he wanted to design a solar house. Somebody pointed him to me. I said, I know nothing about solar energy, but I make a deal. You give me reading assignments and then explain it to me in English. And then I will try to apply those principles to a house and we'll get something done within the next 6 months. So I read every book on solar energy. I didn't know what I was reading. He explained it in English, took notes. I then developed a whole scenario and designed a solar building for him. By the time I got to Oregon, I was the global expert on solar energy and architecture because no architect could read those books. So I taught the courses in Oregon, had great students. We ran programs, simulation programs, and we decided to, I put my foot in my mouth at a conference. People confronted me, and we showed the principles that we developed at Oregon. The engineers got all upset because they were trying to get DOE money, and I was trying to steer it to the architects. And on spite, I said I'd write a book. And I ended up having to write a book because I said I was going to do it. And so that's how
the
that...
And the rest is history.
It's a long story. It's a long story.
These are all long stories, by the way. I'll just warn you. These are all long stories. So let's come back to today, to this morning. I mean, we're really happy that you could make it out here and meet with the Green Ribbon Commission. This is, as you know, a very influential group, and I think Boston is pretty proud of the progress we've made so far on energy efficiency and good public policy. I guess the question is, I'm sitting here trying to take notes and trying to tweet a little bit, and a net zero building code by 2030, net zero building code. You told this to the Green Ribbon Commission, right?
Yes.
And how was that received?
I thought they were great. We got no negative comments. A lot of the builders came up and said, great, we love this direction. We had, two builders came up to me, or building property owners, saying we've been trying to, do this. Before we came up with this plan, we actually did this plan for New York, which is, in scale, much larger than Boston. And when I looked at Boston, the numbers were similar. New York was 71% of all energy emissions is attributed to buildings. So it's the same problem. In urban areas, you're going to get the largest portion attributed to building operations. So when I looked at the numbers, we basically started to come out with a very similar scenario. And you can't get there anymore. But we made it in New York. We talked to CBRE. We floated a whole bunch of things by them. The first thing we floated by them, what are you, crazy? You want to shut down the whole real estate industry in New York? This is not going to fly.
Never heard that before.
Yeah. So we then floated something else. By the time we floated, you can buy your way out at a penny a kilowatt hour. They were happy as can be. Oh, that's, we don't have to do anything? No, you don't have to do anything. You can buy your way out. But if you renovate, then you got to renovate to these standards. But at $1,000 a square foot, what are you going to spend? $1,005 a square foot? Big deal. $1,010 a square foot? They said, that'll fly. We're on board. So we then presented that today, and I didn't see anybody getting upset. In fact, we got a lot of thank yous for bringing it to their attention. So hopefully it'll fly.
Yeah, good. Now you know that Boston and a lot of cities in the Northeast have a lot of old buildings. As you point out, there's a lot of existing building stock here. And I think that the Architecture 2030 and the 2030 commitment has been great in helping us understand how to design for energy efficiency. Right now, I mean, we know what EUI is, we know what light power density is, and we can do that. But carbon neutral is still kind of out there for us. And I think we look at carbon neutral and say, well, how do we actually get our hands around the construction? How do we get our hands around the carbon value of the building itself before you even get to the operation? So what can you tell us about that?
Okay. Well, to get the carbon neutral in building operations, it's get down as far as you can and then either produce the rest on site or import. We say import. At Architecture 2030, we're not a stickler for you got to produce everything on site and be crazy about this. So, you get down, you really push to get down to 60, 70, 80% through design, and then the rest you make up one way or another with renewables. We could care less which way. As you get down in building operations, and our latest codes are getting us 50% of the way there, all of a sudden now building materials and making the materials and constructing the buildings is becoming a bigger percentage of the energy consumption. So, from day one, when you build a building, 100% of your carbon footprint, 100% is building materials and building the buildings. Most of it in building materials. Is all the material that goes into a building. There are literally thousands of materials. Aluminum, coatings, rubber, fabric, wiring, gypsum, steel, wood, you name it, transportation, digging up the stuff.
It's big. Takes, from our studies, it takes about 15 years to pay off that debt of building operations.
That's for new building.
That's for new buildings, right. So you start with 100% carbon footprint is building material, zero is operations. Then in year one, it goes like this, goes like that. They finally cross each other at about 15 years or so. It depends on the building. So it takes you a long time. So if we're building 900 billion square feet of new building, tear down and new building, tear down and out and gone and new building, that's a huge amount. You know, almost half of that is going to be building materials of the carbon footprint. So the materials part now is becoming very important, and we're starting to jump on that.
So we're going to have to drive carbon neutral on the part of the building manufacturers, the building product manufacturers too, right?
What I tell the architecture community is you have no clue as to how much power you have. You are the gatekeeper. You are the gatekeeper of this whole issue. Let me give you an example. How many of you have practices or working with, okay? You know the product manufacturers, how many try to get into the door to stock your shelves with their products, right? We had to beat them. I had practiced for 30 years. We had to lock the doors sometimes so we wouldn't get bothered by the salesmen coming around trying to stock our shelves with their products. Why? Because then we specify their products and they get sales. What happens if we decide all the big offices and little and the AIA and everything, we're only going to specify, if it's somewhat cost competitive, carpet that's carbon neutral. There are a few companies out there that make carbon neutral carpet, so you can actually get a bunch of different types of carpet. And if a carpet manufacturer comes in, he doesn't have a carpet, that you say, do you have a carpet that's carbon neutral? Did you do an environmental, did you do a life cycle assessment? Where's your life cycle assessment? Can you show me your life cycle assessment? Well, you don't have one? You can't put it on my shelf, I'm sorry. You better believe every carpet manufacturer in the world will come out with a carbon neutral carpet, because the architecture community decides, power of the pen. I'm not going to put it into my spec. I'm going to spec it, even if it's a performance spec. Performance, carbon neutral, 80% reduction or whatever. What about concrete? There are now, the American Ready Mix Concrete Association adopted the 50% reduction target by 2030 in the embodied energy and carbon of concrete. Central Concrete, a whole bunch of concrete companies now are meeting through life cycle assessments the 50% reduction below the average for that product type. Now, what if we say, okay, we just specify you got to meet this, and Central Concrete comes in, I can meet it. You don't think every concrete, they're not going to go out of business. So they're going to figure out how to get the reductions. Cut out transportation, use local aggregate, do this, do that, you know. The architecture community is the gatekeeper of every product, not only in a building, which is glass, steel, paint, fabric, coatings, rubber, wiring, lights, you name it. But it's part of the manufacturing process of every product on the planet. Glassware, forks and spoons, you know, placemats, tables, you name it. That product goes into our buildings. If we start changing the products in the building sector, you don't think they're going to change that product and then not their other line. So we're the gatekeepers of the entire industrial sector in the world. Now, if we get together and do something, then it makes change happen. And that's why, no matter what they decide in Paris, if we don't do it, it's just not going to get done.
Well, I know that you said that we're not, that don't worry about what happens in Paris, that's not that important, but for me, to think that we've got, you know, 1.3 million architects around the world, it's not just us, the United States, and now it's a global community of architects that's all starting to understand this too. And you bring those people together at Durban and in Paris, and that's a huge lever that you're pulling for us, right?
Yeah, I think what happens is people say, okay, well, now how are you going to do it? The first thing you have to do is make people aware of the issue
and get them to buy into the problem. And once they buy into the problem, the wheels start turning. So you're not going to see everybody designing carbon neutral buildings tomorrow, but the wheels start turning. Think about this. I couldn't get the AIA, they were coming to Santa Fe, New Mexico, where I'm based. They were having their annual meeting, and I couldn't get a meeting with the board. AIA wouldn't meet with me or anything. It's the old AIA. They wouldn't even meet to hear about the issues. We had discovered the issues by then. So this was months before. I talked to Susan Zanassi at Metropolis. That's a whole nother story, but they decided to give us the cover after twisting their arm a bit. We wouldn't give them the story unless they gave us the cover. They gave us the cover. The cover came out the week before the AIA board got to Santa Fe. They came to Santa Fe. They stayed at the La Fonda Hotel. I walked over. I knew one of the board members. So they came to Santa Fe. They all had their Metropolis magazines in their hand. We still didn't get a meeting with the board. But that started the ball rolling. And then as more people got involved, then you had the 2030 commitment. Now you have firms. Then you had the UIA. Then you had the China Accord and things. Now you have a buildings day in Paris. There was not one magazine, you couldn't. Before Metropolis came out, the environmental community was burning down dealerships. SUVs was the bad poster child, and they were burning down dealerships in Denver and in other places that housed SUVs. I don't know if you remember all that. And, once we discovered the buildings, like the architects started to freak out a little. They're going to start burning our buildings down there? What's going to happen here? But there was no mention. Today, you can't pick up a magazine without, a green roof, a this, a that. We're in front. I go to the hotel, now they're recycling towels. And, if you want, please don't use your towel four or five times before we have to wash it. I mean, and that's only since, 2003, 2004, when we discovered the issue. That's, 10 years. And so growth is always exponential in a sense. So it starts out small and then it grows and grows and grows. We're at the knee of the curve, and then in a very short period of time. So I'm
good.
Totally optimistic.
So to the one question I got on Twitter, how can we be optimistic, given the terrible odds you had earlier in your presentation about us going off the cliff? You give us a lot of reason to be optimistic, right? I mean, where change is definitely coming. We're making a difference, right?
The question is time.
Yeah.
The only question now is, can we get it done in time to avert the 2 degrees C? That's really the question. And the cities that have come out, the Carbon Neutral Cities Alliance, have a huge responsibility because they put their name out there. They want the publicity. They want to be recognized as leaders. They've sat with the Pope. They got invited to the, to the Vatican. They've got their picture taken. They're on the front page. They've got to come through. So, so by getting people to do that, and like Durbin and, and the China Accord and stuff like that, people put their reputations on the line. They don't do it right away, but the wheels start turning. So the question becomes, is can we avert the
right
2 degrees Celsius?
And we'll all find that answer all together, hopefully. You ready for some questions from the audience?
Yeah, sure.
Guys, want to say, okay, all right, we're going to have to play, Geraldo or something, walk around with a mic. So.
You spoke about the 2 degree C milestone, so this is a segue right onto that question. You said if we don't hit the 2 degree centigrade by a certain point in time, it's game over. Can you say a little more about the metrics on that and the timing? And I didn't really follow your graph on that.
Yeah, we have to begin to peak emissions very, very quickly, like between now and 2020. Global emissions now are going up, so they have to peak, which means CO2 in the atmosphere is still going, would still not go up this way, but would go up then in a straight line. And then we have to begin to reduce CO2 emissions in the built environment. It's essentially the power sector and the industrial sector, the products and everything. By about, the scientists say between 2045
and about 2060, we need the 2065. There's a wiggle room in there. The actual average line goes down through around 2050, but there's wiggle room on each side, a lot more on the upside than on the downside, which means we have 35 years to get rid of carbon in the building sector. Now, when cities pledge 80 by 50, they're not just pledging CO2, they're pledging all emissions, an 80% reduction. So that's methane, that's some of the more potent greenhouse gas emissions, but they don't have a long lifespan, but they're very, very potent. So the science tells us to have a 85% chance or better CO2 emissions in the power sector, most CO2 emissions, not all, most CO2 emissions have to be phased out by 2050, all emissions, greenhouse gas emissions, by about 2070, 2080, so that's methane and the rest. That's the time frame we have. My feeling is it begins to look hard very early on, and it gets easier as you move out in time, as we learn more and we know more about how to design carbon neutral. You saw that graph that I showed at the end with solar coming down. I mean, that's like unbelievable, $1,100 a gigawatt to $75, $60 a gigawatt. It's unreal. My feeling is once storage comes in, especially at the individual building level, and it becomes cheaper and cheaper, that's going to do the same. It's expensive now, but it's coming down. As we move out of time, companies are going to find they're going to sell more and more. Distributed energy becomes huge. That means we're all our own power producer, and we can actually store it on site. So for low-rise buildings, it almost becomes your own power plant if you have enough roof space and can generate enough. So as modules become more efficient, you can capture more per square foot of space. People are looking at now paints that on facades. That's a huge area in buildings, especially in high-rise buildings. You combine that with all the daylighting strategies and things like that, and I believe we'll get there.
Great. Hello, Ed. Every time I hear you, I'm blown away. Thank you. We've had some exchanges. I've been trying to go and address education of future architects. And my postulate has been, if we want to go and reach your 2030 target, we need 50% of all graduates to be capable of designing carbon neutral buildings by 2020, and 100% by 2025. Would you please shoot holes into that assumption?
No, that's true. The schools are behind. The schools are way behind the profession. Sorry to say that, but that's the case. The issue has been with the schools is that energy has been taught as a course and not in studio. I mean, that's really the issue. In 2007, we did a global emergency teach-in. I don't know if you remember that. We reached about 250,000 people worldwide. We did it from New York, and we asked the schools. It was for the schools, for education. We asked the schools to do one thing, and one thing only. And it was just to add a requirement to every design studio project that the building design uses no fossil fuel energy. Just one sentence. Everything else in the program stays the same. If it's a structures, if it's housing, if it's a hospital, if it's whatever, just add one sentence. And we said the instructor doesn't even have to know how to do this, but just give it to the students as a requirement. What do the students do when they get there? They get up into teams. The teams go out and do research. They get on the internet. They come back. They do a pinup. This is what we found on the internet on how to get the carbon neutral, we found this, we found that, we went to the DOE site, there's this building in Kansas that's doing it, there's this, there's that. Before you know it, the instructors now know everything there is to know and they've learned it from the students. Right? They didn't have to even pick up a book. So all we ask for is a sentence. This is a sentence to change the entire education. We haven't gotten the sentence yet, but we asked DI, the Design Futures Council, Design Intelligence, in their survey to add 3 or 4 words to the ranking of schools, that the students be, and it goes to the professionals, and then they rank the schools, that in your opinion, are the students being trained to advance the profession or something like that. And we added 3 words, and design to a sustainable future or something like that, so that would be a key element. They adopted that, but I did not see that in the wording of this. I didn't get my copy yet, but we'll see. Because the rankings are very important to schools, and if they fall from the rankings because the students aren't able to produce for the firms, which are now all committed, every major firm is committed, if they can't produce low-carbon projects, then they're not going to get jobs. So we'll see how that plays out. I thought it was going to be this year's, it may be next year's, maybe I thought differently. But what we were looking for is an intervention point where we could have a transformative, where it could be transformative. A very small element that can actually have huge impact. And so we asked for 3 or 4 words. They said they were going to do it, but I thought it was going to be this year, but I'll have to check and see when the issue comes out.
That was a great presentation, thank you. Sort of a two-part question. One is, I didn't hear you mention anything about carbon pricing, and I'm curious whether you think that's actually necessary or whether the work that you guys have done shows that you can get there without it. And then sort of the other part of that coin, or the question is, do you think the rapid decline in the cost of renewables will send negative price signals to the market and we'll end up with poor designs that don't address comfort, that don't address daylight, because we can just plaster the roof or nearby site with renewables?
Carbon pricing would be huge. Politically, it's going to be I don't think given the makeup of Congress now and the fact that new elections are coming up, it all depends. Carbon pricing will depend on who gets in and who's sympathetic to addressing this issue in the next administration. So I don't want to single out any parties or anything like that. We try to stay apolitical. But carbon pricing would be huge. Because if you put a price on carbon, then renewables, then you're sending a huge signal to the marketplace. Although that signal is getting there, but you want to move this thing quickly because time is really critical now. And so the answer to that is yes, carbon pricing would be big. Would renewables be, would we then design business as usual? I don't think so, because you can't phase in, you know, renewables are a very small percentage of total energy production, and fossil fuels is huge. So you're not going to produce enough renewables unless you reduce demand in order to get to that zero point. So I don't see that sending the wrong signal. In fact, the more renewables we can get, the better. And in fact, because demand is now going down, there's, you know, Duke Energy canceled all their Florida nuclear plants, and they were going to build some in North Carolina, South Carolina. I can't remember. They canceled those because there's no demand now. And a lot of coal plants are phasing out. So the demand side is huge. And I think architects realize, are beginning to realize, a lot of them do realize their role now in all this. And so it's just a race against time.
That's cool.
Ed, thank you very much for your leadership over these years. It's really great to to be here in this room and see all the work that's been accomplished. But you talked about renewables in your roadmap to zero, and you said simply doubling what we have today would get us there. And I either misunderstood that or I'd like an explanation of that.
Okay, yeah. So where we are now is about 25% of all our energy consumption is non-CO2 emitting. So that includes hydro, it includes nuclear, it includes everything that doesn't, is non-CO2 emitting. The rest, three quarters or slightly more, is fossil fuel. So it's oil, gas, coal. And so what we've said is, and what I just showed you was the building sector itself, so not the whole world. That was the whole world building sector. That if we reduce demand in the building sector, like we're doing now in the U.S., we do that globally. And how do we do that globally? By bringing all new buildings in and renovations in at a very, very low, meeting the 2030 target, 70%, then 80%, then 90%, then zero. If we do that and we renovate 2-3% of our building stock every year to a 50% reduction, that's actually what our codes are at now. So we get a 50% reduction or 2-3%. That's about in the US, I think it's about 5 billion square feet. It's what we were building before, what we were building new before the recession and what we were renovating before the recession. We're actually renovating 5 billion and building new. If we do that, then, and if we do it globally, then the demand curve comes down. And then you have about this much renewables. If you double that, then by 2050 you reach zero. So that's, so it's a combination.
First off, I want to say thank you for coming here tonight.
You're welcome.
All of us have pretty much drunk the Kool-Aid, which is why we're here tonight. So what's holding back the rest of architects? Peter talked a little bit about education, but like in your gut, what's really holding people back? Is it fear that they'll lose their clients?
No, I don't think it's the clients. I've never had a client in 30 years of practice and a lot of building designs come to me and put his arm around me and say, look, I want my project. I want to spend more money on energy consumption every month, please. It's really important to me that I spend a lot of money. No. We just, you know, as a matter, you know, the client doesn't tell you, you know, it gives you a program, it gives you a budget, you have a lot of flexibility in the form of the building, the shape of the building, the materials. You think they read the spec, you know, it's, you know, the damn specs we put out were this thick. They don't read every, you know, they might, there are a few things they might want, but in general. So we really do control the design of the building. So I don't think, we can't blame it on the client. So let's move them out of the picture. So what's holding back? I think education is one thing, big. We have a lot of tenured faculty. They just, you know, look, the folks from the 70s on, from the 80s and 90s, the guys who were teaching the subject, when Reagan took the panels off the White House and fossil, and you know, he made a deal with the Saudis and everything, and they dropped the price of you know, oil down to less than $10, I can't remember, went through the floors, you could give it away. When he did that, the whole solar movement and design movement just crashed and burned and didn't have to think about it anymore. That was a manufactured crisis. This one's not going away. This is a real crisis, and it's getting worse and worse and worse. In 2003, we just identified the issue. It's been picking up. That's why you're all here. You know, in 2003, I would have gotten four people here. It's happening. The question is, can it happen fast enough? What about the outliers? Why aren't they picking up on this? I think it just takes inertia, and I think the inertia is building, and it's like what I said. You know, the exponential curve starts out like this, and it goes like this, and it goes like this, and it goes like this, and it goes. The population curve's like that too. We doubled our population in, what was it, 2000? So it took 2000, you know, from the time the first person walked on the planet to get to a certain place, it took all that time, and then we doubled that in a matter of 10 years or 20 years, something like that. So we're at the knee of the curve here, and then it's going to go up. So I think everybody will be on board very soon. You don't have all these things happening all of a sudden in rapid fire. Every major firm signed the China Accord. Gensler, thousands of architects now. Arup, Skidmore, DLR, HKS, every major international firm has signed on, plus the local design institutes, Shendai, they house, I don't know, in a building, 3,000, 4,000 architects, planners. I mean, these are huge organizations. They've signed on. What does that mean? The ball is now going to start to roll. We're now getting questions from Arup. Now what are we going to do? Skidmore is now developed. DLR just developed a plan for its offices in China and all over. So I think, you know, I think what happens is you get this and this and this, and you see it happening, but it's not fast enough. And then you get to the knee of the curve, and then it goes like this, and time is on the bottom scale. So in a very short period of time, you get a doubling, and then a doubling again, and a doubling. I think we're getting close to the doubling point, and then I think you're going to see it go just go crazy. And I think everybody will. In a talk in 2007, 2008, in New York City, I gave a talk at Cooper Union. I wanted to give a talk because I went to school at Pratt, and I remember going to Cooper Union to their they had a great space that I can't remember, Thomas Jefferson or somebody gave a talk there. So I wanted to give a talk there. So I said, I'll come to Cooper Union, I'll do it for as long as I do it in that space, because I just remember from Pratt. So they let me do a talk. They gave me, and we had a big audience. And I said, what we need as architects, I said, we're like kids. What we need is real-time simulation, a computer game. So as I'm designing, if I turn the building this way, or I'm in SketchUp, or I'm doing this, or I stretch it out, or I add some glass here, or I throw some, I see immediately that the needle goes up or down, how much energy can something bring. I said, you do that. I said, you guys out there, you could make these computer games where people go and chop people's heads off and blow them up, and you know, and they're running all over the world, and you know, just all sets and stuff. I said, you can do that, and you can't give me real-time simulation for building design. I said, this is insane. This is what we need, because we're like kids when we design. We love to design. We don't want to run and crunch numbers and then send it out to the engineers. We've already sold the client. 3 months later, we get this whole report back of charts and graphs. We don't even know what the hell they mean. And it then tells us we have a bad building, so we throw those away because we sold the client already. We're not going to say, hey, I just designed your bad building. It's not going to happen. Give us real-time simulation. I can see what I'm doing, and I see the needle go up or down. If it goes past this point, it's in the red. If it goes below the point, it's in the green. Hey, I'm doing great. I'm below the 2030 target. Somebody heard us at that. Sapphire. They called me last year, a year and a half ago. Ed, remember that talk you gave at Cooper Union? We just got real-time simulation in our product for SketchUp. Now, it's been a year on the market. They're starting to get market share. People are starting to use it. It's a plug-in. They now have a plug-in for Revit, real-time. They're using DOE2. It's getting more robust. Before, it took a little time, and they weren't sure about the results. Now they're getting more robust. They're tying it into to the engineers and the systems coming in. It's getting robust. Autodesk wants to do it now, real-time simulation. You get real-time simulation, and I'm sitting there designing, and I see that marker, and I see my building in the red all the time. I'm going to start making What if I shade the west windows? Jesus, there must be sun coming in. I'm looking to the heat. The cooling load is huge. You know, I got to, you know, why is the cooling load so big? Well, let me throw some, wow, the cooling load went down. And my electric load, there's no daylight. They have actually a wheel that shows daylight. You're in the red, you're in the green with daylight. I don't have any daylighting in the building. Well, let me raise the windows a little bit. Let me get some throw. Let me do this. Let me narrow the floor plate just a little bit. All of a sudden, I'm getting daylighting. I would kill to have had that in when I was practicing, right? It's a design tool. That's all happening now. There was no Sapphire 3 years ago. So all of this is now happening. We're at the knee of the curve. Once this goes, within a very few years, we're going to be there. We're in Paris. Almost all the days are going to be pledges. Companies are going to come out. Apple's going to come out. All sorts of companies. We're going to get the 80 by 50. We're going to get to zero. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. Countries are going to come and say we're going to do this. There's now over 100 countries saying zero by 50. Over 100 countries are saying we're going to get to zero by 50, and they want a long-term goal. The fight in Paris is over money and a long-term goal. The Saudis don't want a long-term goal. Russia doesn't want a long-term goal. The U.S. is on the fence. All the island nations and the South American countries want the 80 by 50 long-term goal. That all stemmed out of those meetings. So the battle is going to be there, but nobody's saying, how do you get there? So we're bringing Sapphire there and Autodesk there and some people from China who developed planning strategies for China into a how-to session on December 9th, 2 days before they make the final agreement, to give them the courage to actually go forward. So it's going to be the buildings day and then this session that we're doing.
One more question.
That was a long answer.
Oh, thank you very much. I think I came in somewhat half empty and now half full. In both the same place where I was before.
Good.
But
you got your back.
You flipped the
back. You got your back.
This is terrific. I guess, you know, one question, you've thrown out a lot of numbers, and I think that that's terrific. And you've talked about a lot of pledges. And one of the concerns that we have is that it's really easy to pledge and hard to follow through. And I'm talking about that as part of an architecture community, as part of a professional community that is serving higher ed, and we have a lot of presidents who are committed to something that they have no idea what that is.
Yep.
Except for a couple of them who are actually doing it. But what's your thought on how to encourage all of the different communities to follow through on the pledges? They're easy to make, and that's kind of like marriage, right? How do we make this work?
Yeah, they are easy to make. The vows, you know, come easy, and then the work starts. And so it's the work. My feeling is as the architecture community becomes more educated, and they do it by trial and error too. They do a building and then they analyze it later and they go, oh Jesus, what did I do here and what did I do there? Let me not make the same mistake in the next building. And they get better at it. Then the tools get better. Now we have some better tools. Then it's for us to begin to convince the people who are making the pledges that we can get you there. I think that's going to be the key. I think that's what turned around. I honestly believe that that's what turned around the negotiations in Paris to get more confident and have a longer term goal, a better goal on a long term horizon, is the fact that the architecture community, just peaking emissions in 2005, which is what we did in the US, we peaked greenhouse gas emissions and energy consumption in the building sector in 2005. And we've added 30 billion square feet to our building stock then. Sends a huge message that we're actually reducing, so that this can be done. And it's not fuel switching. It's actual energy consumption reduction at the site. So it's EUI. It's actually building. This is not source. This is what the buildings use. We're reducing. Now, not everybody's doing it, but there are enough people doing it that know how to do it, that are starting to do it, and bringing in the new buildings much more efficient now by code, a lot of it's by code, that we're beginning to make these gains. So all of a sudden, everybody's seeing, whoa, wait a minute, this is, something's happening here, and this could actually happen, we peaked. You know, a lot of countries are talking about, well, we're not gonna peak till it was 2050, then it was 2040. China now is 2030. Now China's talking about 2025. And now cities in China are talking about 2020 and earlier. All of a sudden, as people see that these things can get done, the pledges become better and better and better. As the pledges become better and better, then everybody's looking, oh, okay, you don't know how many questions now I'm getting from China. How the heck are we going to, we all signed this thing. What are we going to do now? Ed, what are we going to do now? And I go, well, we'll figure it out. Don't worry, we'll get there. There's enough smart people at Arup and at some of the big firms that, you know how to do this. We're going to have to really, you know, get some. The plan, actually, planning is way ahead of us. The whole new urbanist stuff and transit development and walkable communities and stuff like that is almost getting mainstream now. So the planners, in a sense, especially that group has gotten their act together, and they have now convinced the Chinese government to mandate different kinds of planning elements, that all new cities be walkable communities, transit development, all that kind of stuff. That's going to be, that's, I hear that, that those planning guidelines now are going to be, are going to come down as law in China. Once that happens, in China, they like this, they like to see things fixed, and this is, thou shalt do this, everybody does it. And that's coming, and the guys who have been working in that space for 10 years have been waiting for this moment where Moher and these other big government agencies are now gonna mandate that now new cities be walkable communities, the smaller block sizes so you can walk. They have a whole set of 6 principles that are very, very well defined, 12 strategies that I've just seen come out. So it's happening.
Ed, what we're going to do next, Ed, is get you some dinner.
Okay. Thanks all. Thank you, Jim. Thank you.
I've been to so many community meetings with such an incredible wealth of really, really intelligent people that can debate endlessly the details of very specific things over and over and over and over again, and then on to the next meeting, and then on to the next meeting. And eventually, it's pretty hard to keep up the tenacity of the stance of a strong design.